Minds, Campus Minds. A very good evening to one and all present here.
Today, we have gathered here to celebrate Mindtree Kalinga's second anniversary. 2 years ago, on this day, Mindtree Kalinga was born. Ever since, it has been the host to various people from various parts of life.
It's also a celebration of wide range of happiness to joy that one might have experienced during their stay at Kalinga. It's also an experience that how Mindtree changes your future for better. So, joining us today, we have three eminent personalities who have renowned in their own respective fields. We have with us our co-founder, Mr. Subroto Bagchi.
We have with us State Sahitya Academy winner, Sushmita Bagchi.
We also have with us Padma Shri winner, Shrimati Aruna Mohanty with us. We also have with us an eminent personality who needs no introduction in Mindtree and beyond. We have with us our co-founder, Mr. Subroto Bagchi. Moving on, we will have a talk show with Subroto Bagchi and Aruna Mohanty. Over to you.
Good evening and congratulations to all of us for Mindtree Kalinga turning 2. And any mother will tell you that 2 is a difficult age. Right? Up to 2, you know, every kid is an angel. And at 2, they start chewing the furniture. So we'll be very worried about the next room that comes in here. But it's been a fabulous, a spiritual experience more than anything else. I think it's been a spiritual experience seeing this place come up. Aruna and I were coming here. Aruna was witness to the groundbreaking here, and that was a good 10 years ago. In the groundbreaking ceremony, people from different parts of the world had brought a handful of earth, and that earth was actually consecrated on this ground by students from engineering colleges. So we called it the One Earth Ceremony. So what we have on this soil is soil brought from Gandhi's ashram in South Africa. We have soil from Mother Teresa's home. We have soil from Silicon Valley. We have soil from the breakages of the Berlin Wall. There isn't a place, wherever Mindtree has gone in the world, a little piece of that earth was brought, and that was actually brought in here. And with that soil grew Mindtree Kalinga, but beautifully so, people like you who have come here, and when I say you, I mean the Mindtree Minds, the Campus Minds who are here, and people who live here, like the people who run the place and the delivery minds of Mindtree Kalinga, they stay, but those who come and go, they take a piece of the energy and they live a lot of goodwill, joy, and energy. And with that, this place is blossoming by the day. But more importantly, we have had the great fortune of hosting outstanding people in their own respective fields. People like Guru Aruna Mohanty today with us, who have contributed to the making of what I call a sacred space. So to me, Mindtree Kalinga is a sacred space, and it's energy, its soul has been rarefied by the presence of many different people, and we have Dr. Aruna Mohanty, so I wish that all of us give a hearty welcome to her one more time. I'm actually very, very delighted, fortunate, privileged to be in conversation with her today. You know, Nidhi told me to invite somebody special. The first name that came to her mind was Aruna, and Aruna was quick enough to agree. She's not just opponent of Odissi music, which you know is a more than 2,000-year-old dance form. She's not just somebody who has excelled in her chosen field of work. She's also a person who has given more to life than she has taken out of it. Success has only touched her so much, and her greatest contribution to the world of Odissi is the fact that she has made it contemporary. She's kept the essence sacred and intact and protected, but she has not been afraid to push the boundaries, which in a sense, to me, is the spirit of any activity that we do. We inherit so much. We have so much legacy, but it is our job, while protecting that legacy, to also push the boundaries. And that's what she has done all her life. Even more importantly, you know, she has actually scouted talent. People will continue the tradition long after she is gone. And she has raised them selflessly. So the academy that she has started and which has now blossomed is one of the most respected learning places. So Mindtree Kalinga is a learning space, so you know how important learning is. And she has created her own learning space. But in all these things, as proponent, as student, as performer, as guru, I still feel that what really makes her complete is her sense of humanity. I have seen very few people in my life for whom I have a spontaneous respect for the human being that they are and the role model that they are. So with those words, I know Aruna is getting to be uncomfortable, and Sushmita here thinks that, is he going to ask questions here or is he going to talk all evening? So here's my first question, and knowing that we have limitation of time, I'd like to keep this segment in four parts. I'd like Aruna to reflect on, first of all, making a choice. What makes somebody to make a choice, and what is the essence of making a choice in life? That's number one. Number two, I'd like her to reflect with us on not only making a choice, but facing the consequences of that choice. All of us like to make choices in life, but when it comes to living the consequences of the choice, we necessarily don't like that. We like to make the choice, not necessarily live the consequences of the choice. The third thing I would love to hear Aruna talk to us about is the idea of success. Now, this is a woman of substance. You know, success has come each time she has put her feet on the stage. Cheered when she touched this, you know, first she paid her respect to the stage. So each time she has done that, success has come away. And last but not the least, I would like her to reflect on the idea of leadership, because each one, every mind to mind, is a leader or a leader in the making. So with those words, Aruna, as you look at the little Aruna, maybe 3, 4 years old, 5 years old, I don't know when you were attracted to Odissi, to the time that you suddenly feel that it is my calling. Okay, it's like that light shining on our face. So you see that, you know, that call you, that beckon you. Tell us about that process.
I would like to say namaskar to all of you. And I want to say hi to all of you because I see friends here. And it's very difficult to sit in front of Mr. Subroto Bagchi and talk. And all my life I have been trained not to talk, because in performing art you are supposed to communicate through your body language, not with your words. So I, at this point, am very nervous, I must admit. Since I'm here, I should enjoy it as much. When I first came to Mindtree, just, you know, it's nothing to do with how I got into, where I got the calling from inside. I came to Mindtree first time, I stepped my foot here. There is a positivity in the air. The soul of Mindtree is kind of, there is a calling. And that calling is very beautiful. All of us, all the, my entire team was like, wow, this place has, you know, if I, we could, you know, be here to learn something or to do something, this should be the place of activity, where it is kind of a, some kind of sensation, not to your body, but to your mind. It steers your soul. Thank you for having me here in Mindtree. I must tell you that I belong to a middle class family. And my father had just one government quarter where there were two rooms, one bedroom and one small ante room and one kitchen, one this thing. And we were six brothers and sisters, like siblings, and my parents, my grandmother, my masi, and then extended family and the joint family. So there were 22 people living in that house. Out of 22, some were family members, and 10, 11 people always, they are kind of commuters. They were from literary background, because my father was a writer. So I have seen all big names in Odia literature. They used to come to our house. Then theater people, musicians, dancers, all of them. They used to come, go, eat. And we were sleeping on the floor with a chatai. Six of us, six girls. But when I look back, I think that was the most beautiful part of my life, because the kind of experience I had then, I used to listen to people talking about literature, poetry, and romanticizes the poems, and they discuss about it. And then when I was kind of part of the theater groups, my work is to take the script and read the dialogue from behind. One after another, like that. I was not supposed to do it. Out of my interest, I used to do it. But then my father said, okay, you can act in theater. So if you want to. So I started my career in theater as child artist. Then my father also produced few movies and acted those movies. And then at that time during the theater, there will be small dance pieces in the beginning, in the middle, during the intermission. So I used to watch these dances and I used to copy them. Standing next to the wings, I used to copy it. And then someone told my father she should learn dance because it comes automatically to her and she does it so beautifully by imitating people. So you should make her learn dance. Then I started learning Odissi and I used to hate it. Because at that age, my Guruji was like a...
Sergeant, actually. Sergeant. Sergeant, yeah.
Sergeant. He used to say, 8 o'clock, you have to come here and stretch for half an hour and then practice for 1 hour. 1, 2, 3, 4, it will go on for 60 minutes. And I used to say, my Guruji should have fever. He should not come to my house and I should not see his face.
What lovely thoughts for your teacher.
And with the clappings, with the complimentary words from my friends and relatives, I thought I was special. Because all my friends, they're thinking, oh my God, people love you because you are a dancer. So not because I realized that I was a dancer and I loved it, but I failed for complimentary words coming from my friends and from my teachers and from my relatives.
So you think it's a very important thing?
At that age.
At that age.
Yes.
And how important it is for us to also do it to others.
I have learned one thing. If you think someone is good, praise him or her sky high. That's very important. That's where you are not only inspiring the other person, you are acknowledging his or her ability to do something nice. So I think it's very essential. I remember Sanjukta Panigre, who is the donor of Odissi dance, when after the program she came and said, she told my Guruji, Ganga, you take my words and she's going to be a good dancer. She's really going to be the pride of Odisha. But then I didn't pay any attention to those words because I didn't even understand what is pride of Odisha. So I said, she said something. I came home, I forgot about it. After many years, when she was in the hospital, she was dying in fact, she told me, there are people in Odisha whom we can say pride of Odisha, but in performing art, we have none. After me, there will be non-Odia dancers. We will take Odissi to a greater height and there won't be any Odia girls who will take it up as a profession. That day I had decided that I should take up Odissi as my, not profession, my passion, but...
So what you are implying is that the calling is not just a divine message from upstairs, but in other people's voices, the future may be speaking to you. And second thing you are telling is that a calling to be a true calling must have a sense of responsibility.
I must tell you that people must have experienced the divine existence. I haven't. But I always felt the divine calling comes through a medium. That medium is people.
How nice, how beautiful.
Because when we perform on stage, I experience the presence of divinity in each one of you. Since I haven't seen God, but I experience that presence in each one of you, because performing art transcends the audience and the artist to a level where you merge with that divinity. And that's when you experience bliss.
Beautiful. Very nice, Miss. Very well. Now we'll move to the second part of the conversation, Aruna, if that's okay with you. And that is about, you make a choice, but leaving the consequences. Everybody wants to be a dancer. Everybody wants to be a Nobel laureate. Everybody wants to be a great software engineer. But everything comes at a price. That price is sometimes a personal price. The price sometimes is a price you pay in terms of leaving aside conveniences. And sometimes that price may come later in life when you are setting up a family, and then you know you have the proverbial conflict between what is professional and what is personal. And I find in when I look back in my time, a lot of people want success, want glory, want to contribute without even the idea of glory or success, want to give something, but necessarily don't want to pay the price. So tell us about living with consequences. Tell us about what did it mean to you in your personal life? Did it just happen hunky-dory? Did success come so easily to you? From that point of choice that you made to 5 years into Aruna's life, 10 years, 15 years, where all have been the journey's consequences?
Always as a performing artist, I derive a lot of happiness from doing it. From the beginning, it was never kind of success oriented. Or if I do this, it was never a kind of a planned thing. The life was never planned for me. After I finished my graduation here, I went to London. I did another master in social science from London University. I came back, worked with UNICEF for 10 years. All along I was dancing. Dancing was like breathing for me. So dance was never profession for me, dance was passion for me. But it was never easy. And you can never say there is a shortcut journey to anything, to your satisfaction or to, you know, kind of achieve something in life in terms of, you know, like, you know, as a dancer, when I come on stage, for 30 minutes you watch me, but during that 30 minutes, you judge my work of 30 years. So every time I come on stage, I think I am sitting for my matriculation examination. If I do not succeed today, you will write me off as a dancer. So it's not that I have got a degree, I can say, okay, look, I have a degree, so you have to acknowledge my existence. It's not like that. Another thing is that in this profession of performing art, in creative art, it's very relative. Success as a term is very relative. You know, if I'm doing, I'll just give one example. Ta kartaka de dha tu na, kartaka de dha tu na. He might find it very lyrical and graceful, and he might find it very boring. So when 1,000 people sitting in front of me, I do not know how to touch each one of you. But what a performer or a creative person does, he listens to his or her inner voice, the calling from inside. You just have to satisfy that. And in the process, if that has touched your heart, that's when you call it successful. I do not call my work successful. I do not call myself successful. And I never started my career as a dancer with Padma in mind. Always when people said that you should get Padma, I said Padma Nada is also good enough. As long as people are happy with my work.
Padma is stem of the flower. So stem of the Padma flower.
So when you smile and you say that what you gave us, it touched our heart, and you experience, and it makes relevant in your life. I would like to say just one example. I did a production called Siddharth, and by Hermann Hesse. He's a German writer, you know, you must have read that book. And when I read that book, I read it 10 times. But I was not going anywhere. I couldn't decide how to do it, how I'm going to translate it with the Odissi vocabulary. So I talked to my think tank. There were people there, Sanskrit scholar, Odia poet, English poet, and people from different spheres of life. So I told them, you read this and also come back. Let's discuss how we are going to go about it. So when I did the screenplay, I was kind of trying to take just enough content from the story so that it can link, and within 30 minutes I'll be able to tell you the story of Siddharth. There I thought I am not a dancer when I was writing the script. I thought I am a fine art artist, a painter, a chitrakar. Because in my mind it is a blank canvas, so I was going from one frame to the other, writing and kind of sketching and creating images. I'll tell you one beautiful story. The empty canvas, we call it nagna. Mm-hmm. Nagna means?
Naked.
Naked. So that has no body. So with that nagna, with that empty space, we feel the content in it and we give a kind of a image. So when I was trying to do that in my mind, when I was writing the screenplay, I was like a painter drawing each character, each sequences, one leading to the another. And the link is kind of telling the message that what is happening, which is so abstract, but how you communicate it with the physicality. And to be a dancer, you have to be a painter, you have to be a sculptor, you have to be a mathematician, you have to be a kind of a person with enough knowledge about sahitya, literature. So with all this, when you create something, and you said what are the challenges, after you start creating something and you present it in front of the people, the journey started when you did the script and you created an image, and what you are projecting, what you are giving to people, it's just the physicality of it. Whether it's rejected, whether it's appreciated, it doesn't really kind of make a difference to the creator, because you are already submerged in the process of creativity.
Beautiful, very nice. Very nice.
Let me look at the vulnerable part. Okay, so apart from a dancer, creator, artist, so this is a human being. And tell us what has been your most vulnerable moment as you built your life. Was there ever a time where you wanted to give up? It really felt like, no, this is not worth it. Even for a moment, even for a split second.
There was a time when I couldn't even walk. I had problems with my muscles. I couldn't walk. Every step I used to take, it was intense pain. I thought it's not worth it. It's not worth it. Again, every time I used to go to sleep, my pillow was completely wet because I was crying. But then I thought that only way to contribute is not to perform. There are many ways you can make a contribution. It's not only the satisfaction of being a performer when you are on stage and people will clap and say, okay, good, she's a star. It's not that. So I have a group of young boys from 5 to 12 years of age. I have taken them from their cradle, in fact, you know, snatching them from their mother's lap. And they very happily came, not initially, but slowly. They loved the way we kind of bringing them up. And they're learning dance there. And I'm providing them with education or whatever facility they need to, you know, grow as a human being. And when I see them dance, I said, whatever little contribution I'm making, it's worth living for. And then my team, and I not only, I teach them to be good, like a dancer, but I always think like a mother, I think that they should grow up as good human beings, so they should know how to communicate. So I have kind of invited teachers to teach them how to speak in Hindi and in English, and then I take them to the seminars. I said, take part in the seminars, and you know, overall development, whatever I can do, I try to make them do it. And I compose and choreograph and I organize festival, so they will get opportunity to be seen and for the visibility. And more so, I want Odisha to be remembered and Odisha to be appreciated for what it is. So I'm trying to create a place called Santi Bihar, where all the performing art and creative art, they'll have their cottages. Not only you'll go and see it, but there will be enough opportunity for all of you to try a hand in learning the skill and knowing the skill. And like sand art, there will be a one cottage where sand art will be exhibited, but the sand will be there and instructor will be there. If you go, if you want to learn how to make sand art, you can do it. That kind of thing. And in the evening, there will be a big stage where Chandasoko turning from Dharma, becoming Dharmasoko, that kind of stories, highlighting, glorifying our history, that will be projected. And there will be Odisha cuisine, where people coming from outside, even our own people, they will get authentic Odia food, a clean and hygienic place. And this I want to create. And with the river Daya going, the side of the Holi, I want floats on the river. And there will be at least 20 floats. 10 floats will carry people. The other 10 floats will carry musicians, dancers, and Odia way of doing fashion show, Odia sarees, Odia jewelry, with a song, Jhumka Nai, Gungura Pindi, Phulare Gabha. And like the Odia songs, which is kind of depicting a woman with her aharya. They'll be at the same time, the floats will be going on. And when the sun sets, and these floats are there with the music, folk music, classical music at the background, and you see the glimpses of Odisha on the floats. So that's how I think I'm trying to contribute. And
Wait a minute. So, what was my question? My question was, so what was the most difficult moment? What was that moment in your life when you felt vulnerable? You really wanted to give it up all. And then a 10-minute journey, a discussion about dreams. This is an unbelievable characteristic that I find in all people who have done anything great in their life. They refuse to be dragged by the physical pain that brought her tears in just one quick moment. And then after that, she quickly left it behind. And she's talking about this completely, cinemascopic, kaleidoscopic, multi-hued dream of hers. So how much we want to be bogged down by pain is really a matter of personal choice. And Aruna is a living example of that. And I remember the time that she was so much in pain. We were not so close to each other at that time, but it was so much in pain. Everybody knew that you were really battling and that, this would be a very difficult thing for you to, for a dancer, physical pain is the biggest enemy. You don't have any other enemy. So you came out of that and you have continued to only get better at your work. And I think it's the mind over the body. I see in you a leader in a true sense. I see that many of us in private sector, in government sector, in political life, we deal with the idea of leadership every day. And if you look at the current times, the idea of organizational, hierarchical, command and control kind of leadership is kind of finding its own limitation. And today's leader is somebody who can yield influence without authority. And when I see you perform, many times that I see you perform, meaning you perform and sometimes your groups perform, and I see that, you don't have to speak a lot to get somebody to do something. You don't have to say a lot. You don't have to exert a lot of pressure. You don't have to put your foot down. Things happen harmoniously. There's some people to whom other people listen. Some people have to just, bat an eyelid and a whole country will rise in unison. So, as a leader who has influenced a lot of people, who has contributed influence without necessarily authority, tell us a little bit about what is leadership to you and what should we take away from this evening from Aruna, the leader.
Someone told me sometime that respect is never demanded, it's commanded. Once I was asked by a corporate house that when we are teaching this concept of leadership to our group of employees, we want to use performing art as a medium. Then I thought about it. I don't know how to do it because this was a challenge for me. First time I was addressing a concept like that. So I had taken the instances from Krishna's life. Krishna as a leader. So he picked up seven sequences from Krishna's life and how it is relevant even today in our lives, specifically in corporate life. The first of all, you all know that Krishna organized that Swayambhar Sabha where Draupadi has to choose her husband, right? So everyone was invited, the Kauravas, Pandavas, everyone were invited to prove that they were the best warrior and, you know, the suitable person to. So Arjuna asked him that, Sakha, you knew that I was the best. So why did you have to organize this? He said, equal opportunity for all. Let the suitable or the best man win. So what best way of saying that? And one more thing. Arjuna came and Duryodhan came and asked Krishna that we want you in our side. Krishna said, one side, I am there with no arms and ammunition. And the second side, my 10 million Yodha, warriors, you choose. Duryodhana said, I want 10 million warriors. And Arjuna said, I want you without any ayudha or the weapons. And while doing that episode through dance, and then Krishna says, in your life, options are there. You choose your option. You choose what you want to do, so you cannot make me responsible for the outcome. So like this, we have chosen 10 things from Krishna's life and we make it very relevant. And I also follow in my dance institution. I have 600 students and all over the world I have 6-7 schools, one in Europe, in Sweden, and one in France, and 4 in USA, and 1 in Japan. I remember that not through words, but through action, you have to influence people, you have to convince people that this is the way of doing it. And you have to do it with a lot of smile. And if you know how to slap, you should know how to pat.
Oh, how nice. Thank you so much. Oh, that's beautiful. It's just so beautiful. Very, very well said. Very well said.
I just want to know something about dance. As you said in the first, body movement for a dancer, they communicate through body movements. Like that, for a beginner, which is more important, Abhinaya or Mudra?
You are in a cradle, your mother said, lululululululu. What do? You blink your eyes, right? That's not a mudra. That's your expression. The gentleman sitting there and just did this. You. And I learned that. And Mr. Bagchi is sitting like this. I am learning that too through my observation. So these are poses I am going to incorporate and make it dance. How? Dinak dinta. I just use music and use this human experience. I'll just give you one. Radha and Krishna, when they came to a place to meet, and the friend of Radha says, Bajuchi sahi bajare tonare braja. Everyone is talking about your love affair. What are you doing there? Okay. So says, when you are on the rooftop and Krishna comes from the forest, you look at each other. Ona oni chamatkara. And Krishna is looking at her and saying, oh, beautiful hair. Nose, lips, smile, oh good, I wish, says my beloved. And Radha says, oh my God, the dark complexion and the flute and the peacock feather, he is the man of mine, you know, imagination. All that, have I seen Krishna? Have I met him? Have you met Radha? No. I am learning it from you people when you look at each other and exchange your glances. That's what it is.
You are a dancer, teacher, choreographer, and as well as an administrator. So among all the roles that you do, which role you like the most and why do you like it?
As a woman, I was born as a daughter, then sister to my brothers, and then beloved to my loved one. And then you become someone's wife and the daughter-in-law, and you play several roles. If you will ask me to choose that whether you are a good mother or a good wife or which role you enjoy most, then my answer is silence. That's the best to express myself. Because I enjoy doing everything, because I believe that I am here today. I might not be there tomorrow, but there is going to be music in the air. There is going to be beautiful sangeet in my soul, and both the things are going to merge. Before I end, this one dialogue I used in Siddharth. I would like to just read it for you. The Siddharth story ends when Siddharth goes and meets a person called Vasudev, who is a fairy man, and he's introducing Siddharth, the river. There he says, the Vasudev says, did you hear a voice? Did you hear a voice, Siddharth? 100 voices, 1,000 voices. Voice of joy and suffering, lamentation of earning and the laughter of knowledgeable one. The scream of rage and the moaning of the dying one. He realizes he could no longer tell many voices apart. They all belong together. They all belong together is the flow of events. He sees the reflection of all the dear and near ones in the river, is the flow of events, is the music of life. Is the music of life the song of 1,000 voices? He submerged himself into it. The great song of the 1,000 voices became one, consisted of a single word. That's coming from the soul. It doesn't have any language. It doesn't have any other expression except 2 drops of tears of realization.